Please stand as we sing together number 128, led by the Spirit, number 128.
Led by the Spirit of our God, we go to fast and pray with Christ into the wilderness. We join his paschal way. Rend not your garment, rend your heart, turn back your lives to me. Thus says our kind and gracious God, whose reign is liberty. Led by the Spirit, we confront temptation face to face, and know full well we must rely on God's redeeming grace. On bread alone we cannot live, but nourished by the Word, we seek the will of God to do. This is our drink and food. Led by the Spirit, now draw near the waters of rebirth. With hearts that long to worship God in spirit and in truth, whoever drinks the drink I give shall never thirst again. Thus says the Lord who died for us, our Savior, King, and Friend.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Grace and peace from God our Father, the love of the Lord Jesus, and the communion of their Holy Spirit be with you. Into the desert we go for these 40 days of Lent. The desert, a place of challenge, a place of purification, a dangerous place, but a place where we go not by ourselves, but with one another, and we go with Jesus, who has already been there. Jesus, who will guide us during these 40 days of Lent. So let's open our hearts to receive God's forgiveness and mercy. Lord Jesus, you came to call sinners. Kyrie eleison. Kyrie eleison. Christ Jesus, you have saved us through the waters of baptism. Christe eleison, Christe eleison. Lord Jesus, you invite us to turn and come closer to you. Kyrie eleison. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Let us pray. Grant, Almighty God, through the yearly observances of Holy Lent, that we may grow in understanding of the riches hidden in Christ, and by worthy conduct pursue their effects. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Genesis. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "See, I am now establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, all the birds and the various tame and wild animals that were with you and came out of the ark. I will establish my covenant with you that never again shall all bodily creatures be destroyed by the waters of a flood, and there shall not be another flood to devastate the earth." God added, "This is the sign that I am giving for all ages to come of the covenant between me and you and every living creature with you. I set my bow in the clouds to serve as a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I see clouds over the earth and the bow appears in the clouds, I will recall the covenant I have made between me and you and all living things, so that the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all mortal beings." The word of the Lord.
A reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, Christ suffered for sin once, the righteous for the sake of unrighteous, that he might lead you to God. Put to death in the flesh, he was brought to life in the spirit. In it, he also went to preach to the spirits in prison, who had once been disobedient, while God patiently waited in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few persons, eight in all, were saved through water. This prefigured baptism which saves you now. It is not a removal of dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a clear conscience. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Praise to you, glory and praise, Lord Jesus Christ. Praise and honor to the Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ. Man does not live by bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Praise to you, glory and praise, Lord Jesus Christ. Praise and honor to the Word of God, Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. The Spirit drove Jesus out into the desert, and he remained in the desert for 40 days, tempted by Satan. He was among wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. And after John the Baptist had been arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God. This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. The gospel of the Lord.
Turning and turning in the widening gyre, the falcon cannot hear the falconer. Things fall apart. The center cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loosed, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. The best lack all conviction, while the worst are full of passionate intensity. This is the beginning of a poem by Irish poet William Butler Yeats called The Second Coming. Cheery note, huh? He wrote it in 1919, soon after the First World War, after the Russian Revolution, and in the midst of political turmoil in Ireland with the Irish struggling for independence. He describes a world of conflict and fragmentation, spinning out of whack. That's what the gyre is. It's something that spins. It's where the word gyration comes from. Where the worst of people are full of energy and ready to work hard, while the best lack all conviction. Sound familiar? Even though this is something written more than 100 years ago, it echoes some aspects of our world today. We live in a world of conflict, a world of struggle between right and wrong, where people at the extremes seem to get all the attention, where there's little room for listening, little effort for seeking the common good, where things seem to spin off course, where we too can spin off course. Now, the readings for the first Sunday of Lent have quite a bit to say about how to observe Lent
in such a world. The first reading gives us the end of the story of Noah. The chaos of the flood is over, and God makes a covenant with Noah and with all living beings, all of creation. This is the first covenant in the Bible, and it embraces everyone and every being. And the rainbow is the sign of this covenant. It's God's promise written across the sky. The first letter of Peter, our second reading, uses the image of Noah and his family coming through the waters of the flood to a new covenant, a new relationship with God, as an image of our baptism. We come through our immersion in the waters of baptism to a new bond, a new relationship, a new covenant established by the death and the resurrection of Jesus. This letter was originally addressed to a community that was suffering through the conflicts of their times. And the letter reminds them and us that the aim of Christ's sufferings was to lead them to God, to bring us closer to God. This letter reminds us that Jesus, who suffered, has triumphed and has been raised and is at the right hand of God, where he intercedes for us. Today's gospel from Mark, however, gives us an image of Jesus struggling in the desert. True to his style, Mark's account of Jesus' temptation in the desert is spare, without many details. He doesn't give us any of the dialogue between Satan and Jesus that Luke and Matthew do. However, Mark packs a lot into this very succinct account of Jesus in the desert. First of all, it's the Spirit of God who leads Jesus into the desert. The Spirit impels Jesus. It's like Jesus is pushed into this wilderness to be tested. The desert is a remote place with the distractions of the world stripped away, but it's also a dangerous place with wild beasts. It's a place of trial, and Satan is trying to trip Jesus up, to disorient him, to get him to turn away from his mission, to set him spinning and out of whack. Jesus spends 40 days in the desert, echoing the 40 years of the Hebrews that they spent in the desert, where they were tested and they often failed. With their trust in God worn out, they were constantly filling God's ear with their complaints. In contrast, Jesus withstands the test. He comes back to a world that is also dangerous. Mark just mentions in passing that John the Baptist has been arrested. And Jesus begins proclaiming the good news. His message is threefold. Now is the time. This is Kairos time, a time of fulfillment, the momentous, decisive moment, a time of opportunity. And he calls people to repent. Now, to repent is not just feeling sorry for our sins. It means to change. The Greek word is metanoia, to change your perspective, to change your way of thinking about things. It's a change of heart. And he calls people to believe, which is not simply an assent to truths, but to trust in a relationship with God. To believe in the gospel means to trust the gospel messenger, this Jesus who is doing something new. So we begin this Lent in a world filled with conflict, a world that is kind of chaotic, turning in the widening gyres, spinning in anger and division. where a joyful celebration of a Super Bowl victory can turn into a time of panic. Happy people can be filled with fear in the blink of an eye as they run from gunfire. It can seem to be a time when the worst among us are full of passionate intensity, and the best lack conviction. Now, a friend of mine, Father Jim Keenan, a Jesuit priest who is a moral theologian at Boston College, often says that the root of sin is not simply making a mistake or not following a rule. At its heart, sin is not caring, not bothering to care, shutting out the needs of others because we don't want to be bothered, when caring is too inconvenient. There's a startling example of this in a recent film called The Zone of Interest. I don't know if any of you have seen it. It's about a family living in a beautiful house with a lovely garden, family that loves their children. They're living a dream, except that the father of this family is the commandant of the Auschwitz concentration camp, Rudolf Haas. He's a real person. This is based on a true story. He and his wife, Hedwig, are building their comfortable dream life in their house, which is located right next to the wall of the death camp of Auschwitz, where Dad is managing the death of Jews and others with chilling efficiency. There is mass murder going on just on the other side of the fence, just over their shoulders, and they are ignoring it. They're playing in their beautiful backyard with its swimming pool. They're showing their garden to their relatives while you hear the sound of a train coming in to the concentration camp. And you know it's filled with people on their way to the death, their deaths. You never see, during the film, you never see inside the concentration camp. You just hear what's going on kind of at a distance, but close. This is what the movie preview, the trailer, says about the film. It's about wanting the best for your children, following the rules and working hard, feeling that you deserve the best in life, and entwined with the unspeakable. Now, this is an extreme example of the worst of people, full of dedication to their own interests and just not caring about the suffering outside their domestic bubble. It's an obvious extreme. But we can have similar attitudes. For example, on days when we're stressed out, we can take out our anger on whoever is in our range, often family members. I know I shouldn't lash out at that person. I know I shouldn't say stinging, hurtful things, but I'm tired and annoyed, and I just don't care. I say what I shouldn't say anyway. I know there are people who are in great need, but I have my own problems. I can't be bothered, at least not today. Maybe I'll care tomorrow when I'm in a better mood. We too can live our lives in our own zone of interest, self-interest. We can turn away from others, and in doing so, we turn away from God. In the midst of conflict, this is the amazing thing. In the midst of conflict, even in the face of our own bad attitudes, God wants to renew a covenant with us. God does not give up on us. Jesus dies for sinners and for those who are in the midst of chaos. He offers to save us from conflict and chaos through the waters of our baptism. For those of us whose baptism may have been a distant event, God wants us to turn around yet again in these days of Lent, to change our minds and our habits, so that we're more consciously aware of our baptismal covenant with God. We're invited to pay attention to that covenant. The way we would stop and pay attention to a beautiful rainbow stretched across the sky. God wants to remind us of the promises of our baptism, so that our turning and turning does not lead to confusion and is not a turning of our backs on our own who are in need. Lent is a time to reflect on God's goodness and then to decide on how we will respond to that goodness. So in the midst of the spinning and turning and turning of our splintered world, we're invited again to a different kind of turning, to turn to God, and to turn back to our true selves, who we truly are, beloved children of God, rooted in the life of Jesus, with a world and all its people in our zone of interest. Stand and profess our faith together by praying together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We offer our prayers for ourselves and for the whole world. We pray for the church that these 40 days in the wilderness of Lent may increase the church's strength for proclaiming the good news. We pray to the Lord. For the world, that God's covenant of peace with all flesh may inspire nations to prepare a heritage of peace for future generations. We pray for the people of Ukraine, the people of Israel, the people of Gaza. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
that we who share this planet with every living creature may be good stewards of this fragile ark and reverence it as God's creation. We pray to the Lord. We pray for the elect, those who are preparing to draw near to the saving waters of baptism at Easter, that they may persevere in the covenant that God is establishing with them. We pray to the Lord. We pray that all the baptized, led by the Spirit and one with Jesus, may experience these days of our Lenten wilderness as a time to turn again toward God. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the sick, for all those undergoing surgery, those undergoing treatments. We pray for David Zielinski and all those we know who are sick, that God may surround them with peace and touch them with healing. We pray to the Lord.
Lord,
We pray for married couples. And the Mass today is offered for Lori and Jerry Bukas in honor of their 50th wedding anniversary. That God, who called them to a life together, may continue to bless their love. We pray to the Lord. For all who have asked for our prayers, we pray for Diane Schuster on her birthday, that God will continue to bless her with life and love. We pray to the Lord. We pray for those who have died, that our loved ones who have gone before us may go with Christ into the feast of God's kingdom. We pray to the Lord. And for all the prayers that we hold in our hearts, we pause for a moment in silence. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our
God of the covenant, as the 40 days of the flood swept away the world's corruption and watered new beginnings of righteousness and life, so in the saving flood of baptism, your people are washed clean and born again. Throughout these 40 days, we beg you, unseal for us the wellspring of your grace. Cleanse our hearts of all that is not holy, and cause your gift of new life to flourish once again. Grant this through Christ, our liberator from sin, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, holy and mighty God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. There are baskets in the front of each section. If you want to pass them, there's a way you can help us keep things going. I'm also wondering the meaning of the gasp when we mentioned Lori and Jerry's 50th anniversary. You probably can't believe they're old enough. Sisters and brothers, that our sacrifice and our lives may be acceptable to God, the loving Father. O Lord, give us the right dispositions to make these offerings, for with them we celebrate the beginning of this venerable and sacred time. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. By abstaining 40 long days from earthly food, he consecrates through his fast the pattern of our Lenten observance. And by overturning all the snares of the ancient serpent, taught us to cast out the leaven of malice, so that celebrating worthily the Paschal mystery, we might pass over at last to the eternal Paschal feast. And so with the company of angels and saints, we sing the hymn of your praise as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy,
you are indeed holy, O Lord, and from the world's beginning you are ceaselessly at work so that the human race may become holy just as you yourself are holy. Look, we pray, upon your people's offerings and pour out on them the power of your Spirit, that they may become the body and blood of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, in whom we too are your sons and daughters. Indeed, though we once were lost and could not approach you, you loved us with the greatest love. For your Son, who alone is just, handed himself over to death and did not disdain to be nailed for our sake to the wood of the cross. But before his arms were outstretched between heaven and earth to become the lasting sign of your covenant, he desired to celebrate the Passover with his disciples. As he ate with them, he took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to them, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, knowing that he was about to reconcile all things in himself through his blood to be shed on the cross, he took the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, and once more giving you thanks, he handed the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of your Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Passover and our surest peace, we celebrate his death and resurrection from the dead. And looking forward to his blessed coming, we offer you, who are our faithful and merciful God, the sacrificial victim who reconciles the human race to you. Look kindly, most compassionate Father, on those you unite to yourself by the sacrifice of your Son, and grant that by the power of the Holy Spirit, as they partake of this one bread and one chalice, they may be gathered into one body in Christ, who heals every division.
And be pleased to keep us always in communion of mind and heart, together with Francis, our Pope, and Leonard, our Archbishop, and Christopher, his coadjutor. Help us to work together for the coming of your kingdom, until the hour when we stand before you, saints among the saints, in the halls of heaven. with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and with all the saints, and with our deceased brothers and sisters, whom we humbly commend to your mercy. And then, freed at last from the wound of corruption, and made fully into a new creation, we shall sing to you with gladness the thanksgiving of Christ, who lives for all eternity.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray together as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's offer to one another a sign of Christ's peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body and blood of Christ bring us all together to everlasting life.
Our first communion song is number 663, Hosea, number 663.
Come back to me with all your heart. Don't let fear keep us apart. Trees do bend, though straight and tall, so must we to others call. The wilderness will lead you to your heart, where I will speak integrity and justice. With tenderness you shall know. Long have I waited your coming home to me and living deeply our new life. You shall sleep secure in peace. Faithfulness will be your joy. Long have I waited for your coming home to me and living deeply our new life.
Our second communion song is number 505, Only This I Want, number 505.
I want but to know the Lord and to bear his cross, so to wear the crown he wore. All but this is lost, worthless refuse to me. I want,
renewed now with heavenly bread, by which faith is nourished, hope increased, and charity strengthened. We pray, O Lord, that we may learn to hunger for Christ, the true and living bread, and strive to live by every word which proceeds from your mouth, through Christ our Lord. So there will be coffee and in Pilgrim Hall right after Mass. Feel free to partake. There's soup and other things. There are two traditions in the church. One that doesn't count Sundays as a fast day. Others do. You can choose what tradition to follow. Also, we need people to sign up for next week. We don't have a form, but you can just sign on the back of the sheet that's there. It's just a blank piece of paper if you're interested in making soup or bringing some things or helping to set up or clean up for next week. Okay. Also, for those of you who are free during the day, during Wednesdays in March, we're going to have a book discussion based on the book Learning to Pray by Father James Martin. It's going to be basically Wednesdays after Mass over in Pilgrim Hall. There are some books already in the gift shop. There'll be more coming in. And there are flyers that tell you when we're reading what chapters. So if you're interested, just give us a call at Montfort House, and we'll put your name on the list.
And we also have Lenten reflection booklets. There on the end, and feel free to take extras for home, like people, you know, who might want be interested. It's a little reflection for each day in Lent. The other thing, for those who come or look for daily Mass, Father Don's going to be away all week at meetings. I'll have Mass, but when it comes to how to make the camera work, a pre-K kindergarten kid knows more than me. So there'll be no filming, most likely, but we'll be praying for everybody, okay?
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. May bountiful blessing, O Lord, come down upon your people, that hope may grow in tribulation, virtue be strengthened in temptation, and eternal redemption be assured, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless you, Father and Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us go in peace to love and to serve the Lord.
Thanks.
Our recessional song is number 137. Gracious God, number 137.
Lead us, Lord, into the desert. Lead us through the wilderness. Though this journey we will follow, for we long to see your face. In this time of sacred struggle, in this time of sacrifice, we rejoice, for we remember that you lead us into life. Gracious God, mercy is your name. Redeeming love, you give your life away. Gracious God, we bless your holy name. Receiving love, we give our lives away. Lord, we hunger for your presence. Lord, we thirsting for your grace. When consuming all but you, Lord, all we gain is emptiness. Gracious God, mercy is your name. Redeeming love, you give your life
we bless your holy name. Receiving love, we give your lives away. Teach us, Lord, who is our neighbor, the friend or enemy. When we welcome or condemn them, is it you, or let us see? Gracious God, mercy is your name. Redeeming love, you give your life away. Gracious God, we bless your holy name. Receiving love, we give your lives away.